Tadias, everyone. This is Liban Ebisa from Tadias Magazine in New York. The following is an audio of a recent interview that I did with Mike Endale, who is an Ethiopian-American software developer based in Washington, D.C. Mike is also the head of the newly formed Ethiopia COVID-19 Response Team. The group was formed soon after Ethiopia reported its first case on March 13th. And since then, they have assembled an army of volunteers from all over the world, as we speak, over 1,000 technology professionals, including both here and in the U.S. and Ethiopia, to help the Ethiopian Ministry of Health in collecting, analyzing, and reporting COVID-19 data during this unprecedented global health crisis. Let's listen to Mike.
So the Ethiopia COVID-19 response team is a global volunteer group of, you know, software engineers, machine learning experts, doctors, engineers, just coming together to create capacity for the Ministry of Health in Ethiopia. We started it about 20 days ago. Started with a single tweet, really, just asking for people if they would just join arms. And in the first 24 hours, we saw about 300 people showed up, and just continues to grow. And I think right now we're roughly about, I think I lost count, but we're roughly about 1,400 people as of now, and it keeps growing. And there are like a lot of interesting things are happening. You know, there are different work streams, there are different areas of expertise that the team has, and people are joining arms.
So are they all from the U.S. or are they from all over the world?
No, global.
Okay.
There is actually, the distribution is actually a little insane. Mm-hmm. So whenever we have this hands-on call, hands-on meeting, it's about 12 time zones, all in all, I think.
Wow.
So it's a lot of people from around the globe.
So does that include Ethiopia?
Yes, there are people from Ethiopia as well.
So are this all Ethiopians in the diaspora, or just people generally who are interested in helping out?
By and large, it's Ethiopians, and okay. It's not only the diaspora, but across the board. Again, the idea here is it's not close to only Ethiopia. So there are people from other African countries, from Middle East, there are people from Asia. Yeah.
So my other question is on your website, on the GitHub community page, you note that the the better data collection, analysis, reporting, there is the better response and the more effective the mitigation strategies will be. Can you explain to our audience how the software works and how the data is submitted and what is the public's role in it?
Yeah, so it's not a single product only, it's multiple products that we're building. So basically, the way you're going to find where the virus is, especially in a country like Ethiopia, where actual tests are not all that many to begin with, mm-hmm. is you have to be able to understand how, in the early days especially, who the infected people are, right? And the way you're going to find that is by looking at where symptomatic people are, actually, right? And maybe a lagging indicator, but basically, you'll have to log every other rumored case in the whole country, right? And be able to predict where the clusters are using some machine learning or artificial intelligence data. So the process at which you would go to find the virus is basically you collect data first, and the way you collect the data is for multiple inputs, right? You have... So in Ethiopia's case, for instance, there is a hotline that you can call to. There are messaging bots that would be used to input data to get symptom data from the outside. There's also public forums that people can comment and add, basically report cases, right? If these, reported cases would have to go live in the same database. And from there, you have to follow up on each one of them. They call them vectors, so you have to follow up on each of these vectors to actually be able to get by medical professionals to be able to identify which ones are of the rumored cases are actually suspected cases or not. So there are like processes that they will go through. So data is the foundation to how a response would be. Not like I mentioned, Ethiopia doesn't have enough test kits to begin with, right? So the job is that much harder. So there are a couple of things that the team actually identified early on. There's something called group testing, for instance, which is used in World War II that the U.S. Army used in order to identify people with syphilis. What the soldiers with syphilis. So because they didn't have the test kits, there was a shortage of test kits. This Harvard professor came up with this algorithm that you can use to test one soldier and be able to confidently predict up to 64 in the cluster, up to 64 people's test results, depending on other variables. How close they've been and all stuff like that.
Go ahead.
But basically there are like methods to this madness. Basically, you have to collect as much data as you can and you build some sort of model and you start testing these folks once you suspect there's something going on. And that the test result would not only be representative of that individual only, but you can, using this mathematical model, you can predict the DNA test you've done. You can predict with some confidence about the likelihood of that cluster being infected or not.
Yeah. So
a little more technical.
But it's very fascinating, and it's very timely and necessary and needed. My question is twofold. One, are you right now officially working with the Ministry of Health in Ethiopia? And my other question is, so where does the information come from? Is it from the public doctor's office? Who reports?
The Ministry of Health, so we're not part of the Ministry of Health per se, but we're building tooling for them in order to run with it, right? Mm-hmm. And the Ministry of Health has a different, internal systems that they built up. But, there are gaps in the system that we're trying to fill. So, and the Ministry of Health is ultimately the owner of the data. It's not the volunteer team touching the data. The data is 100% handled by them. We're just building out the set of tools for them.
I see. And so you also mentioned on that community site, the GitHub site, that one of the objectives is to also monitor and respond to fake news, some mechanism to see the current conversation stream and respond in a targeted way. So does that also include providing links to credible news sources, and how do you make that judgment? And also, do you have journalists or media professionals in the volunteer group?
We do have volunteers. We do have people in the team who are volunteering. So the approach is to see if we can put some sort of methodical way of putting, again, using artificial intelligence and machine learning to actually understand what the conversation stream is and try to give an update, right? So I think right now the challenge is the information flow is quite a bit, it's actually quite fast, the information flow. So you cannot catch it once it gets out of, once it touches like the social media circuit. So the idea is to actually see if we can counter that more than anything, right? If there's a counter narrative can be built around false information. So to that end, we have an awareness team, right? An awareness volunteer team that was organized that's just generating a ton of content that's already been approved by the Ministry of Health that's approved by, that's been looked by like medical professionals in the U.S. around the world to actually give feedback on. And it's like a counter-narrative program. It's a counter-programming that the team is trying to do right now. But that's going to continue to be a challenge.
Yeah. I guess my other question is something that usually comes up when you use this type of technology is the issue of privacy and security, and whether how long the data would be retained and by whom. So how do you address that, these issues?
Yeah, that's a real challenge, right? I think one of the things right now, all of the products that we've built have been with privacy in mind, right? So the data repository product that we built, for instance, it's a public open source product. There are things built into it to make sure that, there's no data leakage and such. Ultimately, this data repository would be at the Ministry of Health. Mm-hmm. And so there is some judgment call on that, right? But for the most part, we've been privacy focused, try to get the relevant, only capturing only the relevant information. And if there is like a team of touching the data in any way, the recommendation that we've been laying to Ministry of Health, and it's still the early days, right? So we don't have the full understanding of what's going on, but our recommendation is to anonymize the data, the PII information anonymized before it gets shared. So these best practices, like data contract best practices, are implemented in order to be very conscious.
Okay, great. And so, has the data collection has already started, or you guys are still building the tools?
A couple of products were announced by the Ministry of Health. It's basically a subset of the product that we've been working on. There is a partner in Ethiopia on the ground who's also working with Ministry of Health, and that's helping push these things through. So the Ministry of Health is focused on getting this data, and they've started doing that on a smaller number of products that we built.
Okay. So does products include, for example, mobile phone app that's available to the public, or
it's in terms of, so you took that, the prevalence of smartphone is not all that great, right? Mm-hmm. So it's multiple, like I said, the data streams are multiple, right? So mm-hmm. you can call a hotline number, or you can download an app and try it, or you can download even through the messenger apps like Telegram and WhatsApp, and you can send information.
Okay.
And obviously websites as well.
Well, thank you, Mike. And so I just want to give you a chance also, if there's anything that you'd like to share with our audience that I did not ask you about, that, that you think is important, that you want to mention in regards to this project.
Yeah. I think one thing worth here is there was an ongoing initiative, I think on March 13th, a few days before we sent out the tweet, there was already within the Prime Minister's office, there was initiative undergoing that it was led by an internal folks to see if there are digital tools that would make sense to help respond to this. And we were quickly integrated to that team and we get ramped up as we build momentum on the volunteer side. So it's been a very collaborative thing. It's been so far. And we're excited what this could mean, right? So how it can be impactful for our country people.
And I mean, you are based in our audience is international, both here in Ethiopia and Europe, and it's good for them to know that you are based in Washington D.C. and you're Ethiopian American, and you are actually a co-owner of Blaine Corporation, correct?
Yeah, Blaine Corp.
Blaine Corp.
And we have another startup. Yeah.
Okay, and what is that? I mean, you feel free to flag and mention.
Oh yeah, it's called Moxit. It's a startup that builds technology for childcare centers.
Okay. And how can people reach the Ethiopia COVID-19 Response Team if they need to?
The best place to do is to go to our GitHub page and join the Slack channel. So I can send you that.
Okay, great. So people can.
Yep.
All right, Mike. Thank you. Take care.
All right. Thanks so much. Okay. Bye.